This is CNN, a network of Turner Broadcasting System. This is a CNN special report, America's Space Mission. At the Kennedy Space Center, CNN's Bernard Shaw.
Good morning from the Kennedy Space Center here in Florida. It is now T-minus 20 minutes and counting. 20 minutes with another scheduled built-in hole until the scheduled liftoff of the Shuttle Discovery, taking with it five astronauts and the future of the American manned space program. Just a short while ago, the launch control told us that they closed the hatch there to the orbiter, and they're about to take the handle off. Bonnie Dunbar joins us as our technical advisor. She joined us yesterday. She flew around this planet 111 times. Welcome, and we're waiting. What's the latest?
Well, we just came out of the T-minus 20-minute hold. We will count down until the T-minus 9 hold. At that point, we will hold and wait for reports on the weather balloon and the winds aloft.
And we're now at 18, T-minus 18 and counting. There have been two launches of weather balloons. NASA received what they call a data dump from the first one, and now they're studying information now?
I think we're very close to getting the information. We expect it very shortly. We, again, are still able to hold till 1:41 this afternoon.
That's the window?
That's the end of the window, launch window.
Okay. Tony Clark is standing by at the Johnson Space Center in Houston. Tony?
Good morning, Bernie. I think it was Admiral Truly who a month or so ago said, don't be surprised if there is a delay or two in this first launch of the shuttle since the Challenger accident. And that's, in fact, what we've been seeing, surprisingly, because the weather is much better than anyone ever expected it would be at launch time. I think it was just a week or so ago that we were thinking about a hurricane delaying the launch. Now it is nicer weather than expected. I talked with a former astronaut who's here at the Johnson Space Center just a short time ago. He said that NASA tends to program into the computers in the shuttle a wide variation of wind speeds and directions for this time of year, but no one was expecting the winds to be lighter than they usually are this time of year. In fact, as I say, last week we were expecting high winds, perhaps hurricanes in this area. Over at Mission Control, there is a lot of excitement. Everyone is keyed up, but currently they're in kind of a holding position, monitoring the consoles. The flight controllers arrived about 4.5 hours ago. They've been watching the consoles, trying to get ready, just in case there is a launch this morning. And 7 seconds after liftoff, the control of the space shuttle shifts here to the Johnson Space Center. They're ready for that to happen right now. We don't know when that will happen or if it will happen today or not. At this point, we are all simply waiting for word from the Cape, word whether the launch will be scrubbed or whether it will go in a short time, a little bit later this morning. And that's all we can do right now is wait, keep our fingers crossed, and if it goes today, people here at Mission Control say they're ready. If it goes tomorrow, they will be ready then. I'm Tony Clark, CNN, reporting live from the Johnson Space Center. Bernie?
Of course, Discovery is the number one story, but as we've been indicating all morning long on your network of record, weather is trying to steal the show. John Holloman has been tracking the weather story. John, what's the latest?
Bernie, there may be some potentially good news. As you know, the Air Force has been sending up weather balloons for the past 3 or 4 days, looking at winds throughout the Discovery flight path. With us now is Colonel Ron Rand of the Air Force here at the Kennedy Space Center. Colonel Rand, tell me what you've received in information from the latest weather balloon to have sent back information to the ground.
John, our latest balloon has given us some encouraging results. It appears the winds at upper levels have changed both in velocity and in the direction slightly in a way that lessens the problems that NASA's looking at in terms of launching shuttle this morning.
Yeah, now, before the shuttle can go up, the winds have to be from a specific direction at a specific speed based on the way the computer is programmed, as Tony Clark just explained to us. But are they now within that series of numbers that is okay?
They're not there yet, but they're getting awfully close. The direction is still out, but the velocity has lessened such that lessening the velocity lessens the impact of the winds being from the wrong direction.
I see. So If you were a guessing man or a betting man, would you say this trend, is there a trend? Is it moving in the right direction like over a several-hour period?
We've watched it all morning, and it's been gradually improving and appears to continue to move in that direction.
What happens next? Do you send up another balloon, or have you sent up another one already?
We sent up another balloon. We expect the results back in the next 15 to 20 minutes, and we sent up a second balloon after that one, and we should have the results back at about 10 o'clock.
I see. So that's going to continue, I guess, all the way through the launch window, correct? More balloons going up?
That's correct. We actually have to launch as late as 15 minutes after the launch to continue to check the upper level results after the shuttle goes through the atmosphere.
All right. So if you were to summarize what you just told me, things are not totally right on for this launch from the wind, but they're moving in the right direction.
That's exactly right.
All right. Colonel Ron Rand, thank you for joining us. John Holloman, CNN Live at the Kennedy Space Center.
Now, let's go to Atlanta and Valerie Voss for a launch weather update. What do you show, Valerie?
Well, Bernard, one of the other problems that folks at the Cape have been concerned about for the launch have been showers and thunderstorms that could get too close to the launch site. Supposedly, if they get within 10 miles, it could produce a problem for the launch. We're looking at a loop of radar out of Daytona Beach, Florida. Here is the Cape. Starting earlier this morning, a few hours ago, we saw thunder showers popping up, and as the morning has progressed, those have moved and increased in coverage. They're moving in a southeasterly direction, and as we get to the most recent picture right there, you see that they have expanded and they are coming closer to the area of the Cape, so we're going to have to watch these very carefully as our forecasters at the Cape, unless they get into that 10-mile range. That would be too bad after winds are improving in the upper atmosphere to have thunder showers in the region. Slow things down. And of course, as the afternoon progresses and the sun heats the ground and the surface of the waters, we could get more convection, more rising air, more clouds, and a chance for those thunderstorms to multiply even more. Let's look at our satellite photograph now from 23,000 miles up. Basically fair skies over much of the region, although you do see those thunder showers popping up. High pressures in the southeast, and it's brought generally fair skies and calm winds and plenty of visibility to the region, which should be all good conditions for the launch. The only problem, those thunder showers, and of course the high pressure in the upper atmosphere that was causing problems for the winds and the wind speed and direction, but it looks like that too may be improving. We'll have to see what happens with the balloons they continue to launch down at the Cape. We go back now to Bernard Shaw for more coverage.
And when we come back, we'll show you what a nominal launch looks like. That in a moment. And we join the voice of NASA's launch control, Hugh Harris.
NASA test director Frank Merlino asking that all of the test team personnel switch to a common channel, which they will remain on through the balance of the count. In that way, each one of them is all getting the same information. Prior to this point, they have been on separate channels in order to work the various activities associated with their functions. 15 seconds away from entering the built-in hold at T-minus 9. And we've had verification that the fuel cell load adjust is complete, and we are at T-minus 9 minutes and holding. As we come out of the hold, the ground launch sequencer takes over control, issuing commands for the final critical tasks and monitoring as many as 1,000 different measurements during the final 9 minutes of the count. During this count, which we expect to be extended, we'll be listening for the completion of work which has been underway. The countdown at T-minus 9 minutes and holding. This is Shuttle Launch Control.
Of course, there are other scenarios which no one... I was just listening to see whether they would come back to us. We told you that we're going to show you a nominal launch, what happens when it's really good and when. John Holloman has that report for us. John?
That's right, Bernie. As you were pointing out a moment or two ago, there are lots of ways that the shuttle can get into orbit, but there is, in fact, only one perfect way. We have seen that happen on most of the previous launches of the space shuttle, up until, of course, the Challenger disaster. But in a situation where everything goes just as it should go, the launch scenario looks just like this.
7, 6.
At the moment of launch, shuttle crews look at their watches and begin to count the seconds for 8.5 minutes. If nothing goes wrong in that period, their launch will have been perfect. Here's what happens in the perfect 8.5 minutes. 7 seconds after launch, the shuttle clears the launch pad and begins a 7-second roll maneuver. It will turn upside down for the fast ride to space. 30 seconds after launch, the crew will slow the main engines to 65% of their rated thrust to ease passage of Discovery through a short period of maximum stress on the vehicle. Then, at about a minute into the flight, the engines throttle up to 104% of their rated thrust. Commander Rick Hauck will tell Houston that Discovery is go at throttle up. It's traveling 2,551 feet every second now. The solid rocket boosters burn out and are jettisoned at 2:06 after launch, and the shuttle depends on its main engines to carry it the rest of the way into orbit. The main engines should do their job almost automatically until 8:31 into the mission. They'll shut down at about the point they'd run out of fuel, and then the huge external fuel tank will be jettisoned into space. The shuttle is now traveling at more than 25,000 feet per second. 17,000 miles an hour on its way to orbit. The small orbital maneuvering system engines in the tail will fire briefly to make the final adjustment to Discovery's course. At 39:45 into the mission, the Discovery will be in orbit 160 miles above us.
They're going to mission.
Whether it happens today or at some future day, the Discovery launch, if everything goes as planned, will be just like what you just saw. John Holloman, live at the Kennedy Space Center. Bernie?
John, let's listen again now to Hugh Harris, the voice of launch control here at the Kennedy Space Center.
OTC, CVFF.
CVFF.
T-minus 20 minutes. Dump is complete. Step 909.
Okay, we copy.
Anti-D flight.
DVD, OTC.
This is DVD.
Right, we're ready for step 917.
That's what I was trying to get with you earlier.
Okay.
What I wanted to do is, with the delay in putting the closing the crew hatch, we want to work that about 10 minutes before coming out of the 9-minute hold.
This is Bonnie, shuttle launch control at T-minus 9 minutes and
what
holding.
What you're seeing right now
at the present time, astronaut office chief Dan Brandenstein taking off in the shuttle training aircraft to fly approaches to the runway and to take a look at the weather here in the Kennedy Space Center area. As far as we know at this point, the weather here is not a problem, and we have received back the results from the 8 o'clock balloon run, and it shows that we're very close to having the proper margins in order to launch this morning or this afternoon. The people who do loads analysis are in the process of taking a look at those winds and running through their computer programs to determine whether we can launch today. But in the meantime, we're continuing on with the process here. We completed the dump of the general purpose computer and now the comparing of that with the programs in the computers here on the ground is in process. In the meantime, back at the Johnson Space Center, everything is in readiness there, and we switch to them for an update.
And this is Mission Control Houston, the Ascent Flight Control Team with the Flight Director Gary Cohen and Capcom John Creighton have been in the Mission Control Center for several hours, monitoring systems on board the Space Shuttle Discovery and keeping an eye on the weather at the transatlantic abort sites and at Edwards. Voice checks between the crew and Houston have been conducted. All positions in the flight control room appear to be go at this time. This is Mission Control, Houston.
Did you copy, NTD?
Go ahead.
Back here at the Kennedy Space Center, we're continuing on. We have not set a new T-0 yet, as we're trying to assess exactly how long it's going to take to complete the work before we can pick up the count at the T-minus 9-minute point. We expect to hear that just a short time from now. The countdown clock at T-minus 9 minutes and holding. This is Shuttle Launch Control.
Bonnie Dunbar, Hugh Harris, Launch Control voice, whom we just heard, had indicated a short while ago that they're about 30 minutes behind, regardless of where they place this next hole. So it's going to be some time. It certainly will not be a 10:59 launch this morning.
Yes, they left the hatch open for a while before they closed it out. So their programmed activities, I think they delayed until we got a better handle on what we might launch to. And so we'll wait and see what happens.
Here we see the vapors coming there from launch pad 39B. And what NASA's doing is proceeding very methodically, because they know that that window closes at 1:41 p.m. this afternoon Eastern time.
That's true. That's when we have sunset at our transatlantic abort site in Morocco. Then would have to leave the vehicle and try again tomorrow. There is a very detailed set of procedures for each one of the console members in launch control that we have we follow. They've been trained too many times. They simulate just like we do at mission control. And they have a checklist, and we have to make certain that each one of those items has been checked off and verified before we go to the next step.
As our CNN viewers tune in now around the world watching the expected launch of the Discovery, what are the five astronauts doing at this moment?
Well, since they got into the vehicle, they have been working out of something we call the ascent checklist. And there are certain functions they perform. They load some software into a backup computer. They are looking at the landing site data, if we have to land a transatlantic abort or if we had to return to landing site. And right now, as part of the T-minus 9 hold, they're waiting like we all are. We have this built-in hold because it allows us to do things like catch up in the timeline. It also allows us to get a last-minute weather update. And in fact, the checklist will tell us that we do a weather update and we wait for the go for launch, and everybody has to agree to that.
Now, you were aboard the Shuttle Challenger in 1985. You made 100 orbits of the Earth, but you sat there in the orbiter on your back for 2 hours before liftoff?
About 2.5 hours. It's slightly different for this crew. When I launched, we were wearing blue coveralls and what we called LEH helmets, and they were fairly light. We now have these special suits, pressure suits for the crew. They're much bulkier, they're a little bit warmer, so they're probably not quite as comfortable. So this is a real test in endurance, I think, to sit through this hold.
And it's a bit bulkier in that cabin now on the flight deck and down below where the fifth member is because of the added safety features.
Well, of course, there are some safety features added, but I think if you had to look at it on a percentage basis, there is more bulk, but it's not significant.
A lot of people down here are watching this scene, Launch Pad 39B. John Zarella is with the VIPs and other folks who are in a special section, but they're not as close as they used to be, John.
That's right, Bernie. The safety considerations following the Challenger accident dictated that they move this VIP site where some of NASA's special guests and dignitaries are from 3.5 miles to the launch pad to about 7.5 miles to the launch pad. Safety, of course, a big concern. I think Admiral Richard Truly, the Associate Administrator for Space Flight, told me a couple of days and put it quite clearly that the United States doesn't print enough money to make space flight entirely safe. And because we're dealing with a machine and because problems can develop, the astronauts have been given a series of abort scenarios which will enable them to bring the shuttle back to Earth safely. The space shuttle is a machine, and machines can fail. Because it is an imperfect system, NASA has built in several of what it calls abort scenarios. If the vehicle should, for example, lose one of its three main engines, suffer an electrical failure, cabin or fuel leak, the crew would have four options available. The first and most desirable is called an abort to orbit.
I can't make the orbit I want, but I can still make orbit. This contingency would be used if one of the main engines went down after the first 8 minutes of flight and the vehicle had enough velocity and power to make a 105 nautical mile orbit. A standard orbit is 160 miles. The second option is called abort once around. In this case, instead of going into orbit, the shuttle would circle the Earth once and come back to the United States, preferably the lake bed at Edwards Air Force Base, but possibly White Sands, New Mexico, or the Kennedy Space Center. The third option is called a transatlantic landing. In this instance, the shuttle would fly across the Atlantic, using up its fuel, and then dumping its huge external tank before landing at one of four sites in Spain or North Africa. The final option is a worst-case scenario called the return to launch site, or RTLS abort.
There are a lot of unknowns. That the margins in some cases are very small. This is a backup against the wall. You know, I got my backup against the wall situation. I've got to do it.
Here, the vehicle suffers a major failure within the first 4 minutes after liftoff. It flies out from the Cape, using up its solid rocket boosters and the fuel in its external tank. At a predetermined point, the vehicle does a powered pitch around. It will then be flying backwards away from the Cape until the engines overcome the outward velocity of the vehicle and it begins heading back to the launch site. As it heads to the landing strip, the nose is pitched down in order to dump the huge external tank.
And when the tank came off, the air loads would be underneath here, and they'd push the tank back up into the orbiter. So it's real apparent that what I've got to do now is I've got to go from this attitude down to this attitude.
This complicated maneuver takes about 22 minutes. Although computer data says it would work, no one knows for sure if the vehicle would survive the aerodynamic stress. John Zarella, CNN, at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida.
Bernie, they say that those abort scenarios that they practice them over and over again, and of course the return to launch site, the most difficult, is practiced extensively by this astronaut crew. Engineers tell us it works about 95% of the time in the shuttle simulators in Houston. The only times that it doesn't work is when so many problems are thrown at the astronauts that they just completely lose control, something that would probably not happen even in a worst-case scenario. This is John Zarella reporting live from the VIP site.
I'll tell you, John, after the many hours of reading all of the NASA booklets that I and the CNN staff have read, just watching that last piece explained so much, so very much about what they would do if and when. Well, just as you're watching around the world, watching what's happening here at Launch Pad 39B, here in the state of Florida, just beyond the gates of this place, they tell us that an estimated 1 million people or more, all the way from the Yukon, are down here. And when we got out of bed at 4:30 this morning to leave at 5:30 to get here at 6, you should have seen the traffic jam. Hundreds and hundreds and thousands of cars. Well, when we come back, we'll check in with Houston, the Johnson Space Center, and get the latest update from those folks as your network of record continue its live coverage of the shuttle discovery when it lifts off.
This is CNN, a network of Turner Broadcasting System. This is a CNN special report, America's Space Mission. At the Kennedy Space Center, CNN's Bernard Shaw.
The latest we've learned here is that NASA is planning to restart the clock. It has that built-in hole, but they're going to restart it at 11:21, 21 minutes past the hour. And that is the hole right now at T-9. There are some 5,000 members of the news media covering this launch from all corners of the globe. For the last shuttle launch, Challenger, there were just about 500 journalists down here. And those who were not here learned a lesson that shuttle flights may have been proceeding on a regular schedule, but that they could not be considered routine. John Holloman joins us once again to take a look at what else we may have learned from a disaster, one that is still so very utterly fresh in our minds, one that in just about three months or so will have been 3 years. Of course, we refer to the Challenger. Correspondent John Holloman will be telling us about that in just a second. Let's listen in, though, to the voice of launch control.
The briefing that he normally gives at the T-minus 20-minute point, in which he briefs the team on the way in which holds may be called and on the various information that they need to know during the final part of the countdown. One of the things which he mentioned was that the window will extend for this morning's launch from 11:30 a.m. To 1:30 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time this afternoon. The COLA, which he referred to, is a collision avoidance time, and we will not launch from 12:13 to 12:19 to avoid any possibility of collision with objects which might be in orbit at the present time. Not only are we concerned with any collision, but also with coming too close to any of the large orbiting objects, such as the Soviet space station Mir.
Yeah, we're approaching our upper limit on the PPO2 sensors. Wonder if we can ask the crew to stop and close the valve.
Walk out.
PPO2 to ISO.
Go to ISO.
Yeah, this is PPC.
As we were saying, we noted that there were about 500 journalists covering the launch of the Shuttle Challenger. Today we have more than 4,000 journalists down here. And certainly the news media have learned that you cannot take any launch of a Shuttle orbiter as routine. And let's go to John Holloman now, who's got more on some other things that cannot be taken for granted. John?
You know, Bernie, for the past 32 months, the people in NASA and all the contractors who work on the space shuttle for NASA in the Congress, in the Reagan administration, and in the public have been thinking about the pictures that they saw live on CNN from the very place where I am standing 32 months ago. And after looking and compiling all the lessons that different people had learned, we have come up with sort of a synopsis of the many, many lessons of Challenger. The Challenger would have flown successfully if the weather at Cape Canaveral had been warm. The morning of January 28, 1986 was icy cold here. So when the Challenger's solid rockets ignited, cold-stiffened putty in the right lower field joint simply gave way, sending hot rocket exhaust gases into the joint. The 6,000-degree gases found no resistance at a cold primary O-ring, and because the rocket was bulging from pressure, the second O-ring was not sealed either. And again, the hot gas blasted to the outside. 2.5 seconds later, the shuttle continued to rise, and the deadly booster fault was sealed temporarily by burning aluminum oxide from the rocket exhaust. When Challenger passed through high winds at the point of maximum dynamic pressure about a minute into the flight, that temporary seal was broken, and 6,000-degree flame burned through the lower half of the external tank where the liquid hydrogen was stored. Seconds later, the rocket nose struck the top of the huge tank, releasing liquid oxygen, which mixed with the hydrogen, causing the explosion and destroying the Challenger nearly 9 miles above the Earth. Within a week of the accident, a presidential commission headed by former Secretary of State William Rogers was hard at work on Challenger, meeting with all the principals, attempting to raise the curtain that surrounded the space agency. It took the Rogers Commission 6 months just to find out what happened. And it uncovered what the commission called a more serious problem. NASA was not communicating with itself and was keeping some problems, such as the history of O-ring faults, secret from top management. In the 32 months since the accident, NASA and commission members say these problems have been dealt with.
They've not only done all the things that we recommended, but they've gone beyond that and fixed the things that they themselves knew were wrong and which they continued to fly with even knowing that they were wrong.
A team of rocket scientists from booster maker Morton Thiokol and the space agency spent years fixing the problems and remaking the boosters that are going to send Discovery into orbit. There have been hundreds of changes made in an effort to make the shuttle safer. More than 50 in the boosters, 200 in the orbiter, and scores in the main engines and other systems.
We have improved the reliability of the redesigned solid rocket motor significantly over the solid rocket motor that flew on the Challenger, to where it's a very safe and reliable motor.
The other problem with people is harder to solve, but NASA is working on it. All the major figures who were involved in the decision to launch Challenger in the cold resigned, retired, or were replaced. New lines of communication have been opened to make sure anyone who suspects a problem with the shuttle can have that concern investigated and put to rest.
The biggest change for the good is the openness. There were clearly, as a result of the Challenger accident, a lot of mistakes made by a lot of people. Nobody was prepared for that.
I think the communications are quite open now. And so everybody's upbeat and we're ready to go do it.
But everyone in NASA, from top to bottom, knows that human beings can and will make mistakes. And someday in the future, there will be another shuttle accident. The space scientists say their job now is to guarantee that the time of the next accident is as far into the future as they can make it. John Holloman, CNN at the Kennedy Space Center.
Let's listen in now to launch control for a moment.
Red blood cells experiments.
I presume we'll get an update on availability.
An isoelectric focusing experiment, which is a technique for separating compounds by utilizing the differences in their electrical and chemical properties. Another is the protein crystal growth experiment.
This will be your camera.
And the physical vapor transport of organic solids experiment. This is a 3M experiment. Which is to obtain thick and highly ordered crystalline films on selected substrates. The countdown continuing on, we're in the process of completing the cabin leak checks and the venting of the cabin pressure into the payload bay. Everything going satisfactory as we look for a liftoff at 11:30 a.m. this morning. This is Shuttle Launch Control.
$2 billion of American taxpayers' money was put into this orbiter that you're looking at. Safety improvements, improvements that were deemed necessary by not only NASA officials, but the Rogers Commission. And when we come back, we're going to talk intimately about some of the critical changes made. Now let's listen to the latest from Launch Control. An important poll is being conducted among the directors,
to verify that they are sure that we should continue on, and he will report his findings to the launch director.
Since the Challenger accident, the Shuttle Discovery and its systems have undergone close inspection and overhaul. Literally hundreds of changes have been made on the orbiter, the external fuel tank, the shuttle main engines, and the solid rocket boosters. Several of the more obvious changes involve safety, specifically in the area of getting the crew out of the shuttle in the event of an emergency. The Discovery is the first shuttle to provide a way for the crew to bail out. If an emergency were declared where the spacecraft is gliding and could not get back to a runway after launch, the crew would leave through a side hatch. They would get an assist from a small rocket pack. This boost, combined with a long telescoping pole, is designed to push the crew members far enough out of the hatch to make sure they do not fall into the shuttle's wings. Once clear, they use these parachutes for descent, and they will be carrying survival gear. If an emergency were to happen before launch, the astronauts and mission specialists have been given a new way to exit the pad. Once out of the orbiter, they are supposed to hop into a couple baskets, which are suspended from a wire leading to the ground. Then they just slide down this wire. A system of nets has been set up on the ground to slow and stop the baskets as they reach the bottom. An armored personnel carrier is left on standby to whisk the crew away from there. Perhaps the most important changes are those made to the solid rocket booster joints, which are blamed for the Challenger accident. The joint has been beefed up. An extra lip has been added to make it more sturdy, and an extra rubber O-ring is in place. On the outside of that O-ring is in place to prevent the gases from escaping. On the outside of the joint, a new heating system has been added. It is designed to keep the joint temperature above 75 degrees Fahrenheit, no matter what the outside temperature. In addition, internal changes have been made with the intent of using the rocket's own thrust to provide a tighter seal at the joint. Joining us now with more on this very important change, Keith Henson, solid rocket seal expert. You have a model of the old and the new.
Yes, Bernie, I do. This is a model of just the joint itself, which is a slice out of the cylinder of the overall solid rocket motor. The particular one that I'm holding here is one from the 51L, our Challenger launch. And as you can see, it included two O-rings, a simple tang clevis arrangement.
These are the two O-rings there.
Yes, only a slice of them. In their totality, they would go 360 degrees around the solid rocket motor case.
Mm-hmm.
The basic function of the joint, of course, is to contain the chamber pressure due to combustion of the solid rocket motor from this side, preventing it to escape through the crack of the tang clevis joint to the outside.
Now, Keith, before
the O-rings pressed in are theoretically provided to accomplish that function.
Could you show, just hold up the new with the old before you continue, just so viewers can see what the two look like side by side?
With respect to the tang clevis arrangement, the augmentation or the design enhancement is very simply the incorporation of a capture feature, as we call it.
Okay, let's turn. Let's point that to the other camera. That's right. Now, could you hold them side by side, just so that viewers can make a comparison? Okay. And the new one is this one.
The one in my left hand is
the new one. Okay, that's the new one.
With the capture feature, the one in my right hand is the old 51L design.
Okay.
The basic function, of course, of the capture feature is to prevent deflection of the tang versus the clevis when you go from zero pressure to like 1,000 PSI inside the motor case at ignition, which obviously would cause a deflection in the system and give the O-ring mating surfaces to the structure the opportunity to deflect. The presence of the capture feature locks things in place and prevents that kind of thing.
Before you continue, we just want to point out to our viewers that in 4 minutes they will resume the count. An 11:30 launch, weather permitting, the count will resume in 4 minutes. Keith, picking up on what you were saying, are you satisfied with this? Is it adequate?
Well, we've had what we consider to be a very extensive test program.
Mm-hmm.
This particular redesigned joint has been tested on approximately 40 full-scale pressurization tests, some of those under very adverse conditions with intentional flaws built into the hardware, in order to penetrate the hardware to the secondary and the primary O-rings and demonstrate their functionality. There are other features to the basic design, namely the internal insulation that sits over the joint has also been redesigned to incorporate what we call a J-seal, which under the augmentation of the chamber pressure in ignition locks the insulation in place and in fact prevents the pressure and hot gases from really ever getting to the O-ring seals.
The J-seal directs the gases away.
That's right. But we have run tests in this 40 test that I mentioned where we flawed all of that system and allowed the hot gases and the high pressure to reach the O-rings. So we feel quite confident by demonstrating our redundancy and primary functions that we have a good system.
Thank you. We're going to pause and we'll be right back at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Countdown scheduled to resume any second now. Let's listen in to launch control.
Weather's report.
CDR, we copy. We need a repeat on weather.
Yeah, he's down in the mud.
Cape weather, launch director, you want to summarize the current op again, please, sir?
Roger, sir.
Stand by. Cape weather, you're very weak. Can you try another comm?
This is Cape weather on 312. How do you hear me?
Well, you're very weak, but readable. Discovery, can you copy Cape weather?
Negative. Would you just relay his report, please?
Okay, Rick. Well, what we've got in the local area is winds are northeasterly and they're less than 10 knots. Current weather conditions, we got some scattered low stuff below 5,000. We got some showers offshore that are topping out around 14,000. None of that is within 10 miles.
Okay, thanks very much.
Go ahead, Cape weather.
Roger, sir. We have small showers in within about 10 to 11 miles here to the west of the
county. I copy, and they're moving to the west. Okay, and you're still go, Cape weather.
ITD, ITD, 212.
Go, ITD.
Sequence 16973, hold fire system is available.
I copy it. Payloads, are you ready for a count resumption?
We're ready for count resumption now. We need an AT-0.
Okay, copy. Okay, this launch director, why don't you set that for, we come out of the hold in approximately 3 minutes.
I copy, and TLS, NTD.
Would you set the clock to come out at 1528 GMT?
I copy.
And about 3 minutes, 10 seconds for thereabouts.
How do you expect us to know what's going on if you keep talking to us?
This is Shuttle Launch Control. We have just heard Launch Director Bob Seek receive a go from all elements of the launch team, including Bob Crippen, who is the Deputy Director of the National Space Transportation System and the head of the Mission Management Team. We'll be picking up the count down clock at 11:28 at the T-minus 9-minute point, which would give us a liftoff time at 11:37. Eastern Daylight Time this morning. During this period, recorders which document the operation of the final minutes of the countdown and the flight recorders have been turned on. Just 1 minute before the countdown resumes, the OASIS payload in the orbiter bay will be activated to report its findings at the high bit rate. The OASIS instrumentation is designed to determine the environment of the payload bays, such as the effects of temperature, pressure, vibration, and will be used for the design of future payloads and upper stages.
And we'd like you to consider us closing our visors a little bit later in the count just to lessen the probability of getting that TPO2 alarm.
Okay, we copy. Do you have a recommended time?
2 minutes.
2 minutes? We copy.
That's affirmed. 2 minutes.
We copy.
A minute and a half away from picking up the countdown. We've just had a request from the crew that they close their visors a little later in the count at the T-minus 2 minute point.
COEX OTC.
Tony Clark, you're at the Johnson Space Center in Houston. How's it looking over there?
Bernie, everyone is excited here. The news that we just had that everything appears to be go for a launch here in just about 10 minutes or so has brought a little bit of excitement both at Mission Control and here in Building 9A. This is the building where a lot of the simulators are. We have people, NASA employees, that have been standing around monitors. These are monitors that show what is called NASA Select. It's pictures of the launch. You hear from Hugh Harris, things that are going on at the Cape. People have been gathered around around those all morning long, waiting for word whether or not there was going to be a launch. There was kind of a feeling of a little disappointment a short time ago when weather was holding things up. But the news that we had just a short time ago has kind of brightened everyone's spirits, not only here, but in all the buildings, I think, around the Johnson Space Center. Over about a block or so away at Mission Control, people have been getting ready for now more about 5.5 hours. They've been manning the consoles. They've had a dump of data. They've had data move from the Kennedy Space Center here to the Johnson Space Center so that the computers here match the computers at the Kennedy Space Center. The information. We just got word they are starting the countdown again. The countdown is resumed. Less than 9 minutes before launch, and that's the kind of thing that these people, in fact, the people all around here at the Johnson Space Center have been looking forward to. I see smiles behind me. There are smiles in Mission Control as everyone gets ready for this launch. It is something that the people here have been waiting 2.5 years for. I remember some of the astronauts and many of the people at the Kennedy Space Center and the Johnson Space Center have been saying they didn't want to get too excited. Let's go now to Hugh Harris.
And Flight OTC, I'd like to have you proceed with the transmission of the stored program command.
Coming up the 8 minute point, T minus 8 minutes and counting.
Flight OTC.
The orbiter test director has requested that Houston send the stored program commands, which is the final update on antenna management and frequency changes. This ensures that the orbiter has the latest information to speak to various ground tracking stations as it circles the Earth.
Roger. Flight, proceed with transmission of the stored program commands.
T-minus 7 minutes, 30 seconds and counting, and the ground launch sequencer has started retracting the orbiter crew access arm. This is the walkway used by the astronauts to enter the orbiter. In case of an emergency, the arm can be placed back into position within about 15 seconds.
Okay, we copy.
And tense. Intense anticipation picking up. You can feel it here. We're going to pause and we'll be right back to the Kennedy Space Center. Discovery is inching closer and closer to the moment of truth. Let's listen to launch control.
Power units, which provide hydraulic power for steering and controlling flight surfaces. T-minus 5 minutes and counting.
Let's go for orbiter APU start.
And BLT, perform the APU restart.
Roger, inward.
Pilot Dick Covey now is flipping the three switches in the cockpit to start each of the three APUs. The liquid oxygen replenishing of the LOX tank has been terminated at this point, and the liquid oxygen fill and drain valve is closed. 4 minutes, 30 seconds.
Copy that.
The auxiliary power units up and running, according to pilot Dick Covey.
VDR reconfigure heaters.
Roger, that's complete.
Coming up on the 4 minute point in the count. The crew has would normally close their visors, but will delay that. The main engine final purge sequence is underway. The orbiter flight control surfaces, such as elevon, speed brakes, and rudders, are now being moved through a pre-programmed pattern to verify that they're ready for launch. T-minus 3 minutes, 30 seconds. All three engines now being moved in a pattern to verify their readiness to support the ascent flight control. After going through their paces, they'll be aligned to their start positions. We're coming up on the 3-minute point in the count at T-minus 2 minutes 55 seconds. The start of the external tank liquid oxygen pressurization will begin. 3 minutes and counting. And the gaseous nitrogen purges of the main engines will be terminated.
Go for ETLO2 pressurization.
The ground launch sequencer has started to retract the gaseous oxygen vent hood.
That man is Gary Cohen. He's at the Johnson Space Center in Houston. 7 seconds after Discovery is off the launch pad at 39B, his will be the voice you will hear for the duration of what's happening with the Discovery.
Fuel cells has been turned off. Discovery is now running on its onboard reactants. T-minus 2 minutes and counting. Liquid hydrogen replenish of the external tank has stopped, and pressurization to flight level is underway. The vehicle is now isolated from all ground propellant and fluid loading equipment.
Roger, that's complete.
ELS is go for ETLH2 pressurization.
T-minus 90 seconds and counting. Less than 2 minutes away from the launch of STS-26 and its crew of five. And we have heard that the clock will hold at 31 seconds.
STDSC, it's a cabin pressure rate of change. Okay, copy.
We're anticipating the clock will hold at T-minus 31 seconds due to a failure. We have not heard what that is yet.
It's going down. Probably due to the increase in the O2 going in from the suit.
Okay, with your concurrence, we'll clear the air and proceed.
T-minus 50 seconds and counting. We're going to clear the air and proceed. Had a concurrence from the launch director to proceed.
And if we clear, we will not stop at 31. Is that true?
That's correct, MTD. Thank
we
you.
Will not stop the clock. The orbiter computers have positioned the vent doors. T-minus 31 seconds. We have a go for auto-sequence start. Discovery's four redundant computers have assumed. T-minus 23 seconds and counting. The SRB nozzle profile. T-minus 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. We're go for main engine start. 7, 6, start, 3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff! Liftoff, Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger, roll, Discovery. Earth control program, Houston now controlling. 3 inches, 104%. Velocity 2,300 feet per second, altitude 5.9 nautical miles, downrange distance 3 nautical miles.
Discovery, go at throttle up.
Roger.
Discovery given a go at throttle up, 3 engines at 104%, velocity 3,200 feet per second, altitude 10.8 nautical miles, downrange distance 8 nautical miles.
Yeah.
5 seconds from solid rocket booster separation.
Bonnie Dunbar, I am brain. How do you feel?
Well, it's not over yet, but it's looking very, very good.
Well, there was a great relief once they got past in the flight where Challenger exploded. And everyone, you could feel the release.
Well, we made it through the max dynamic pressure, and that's it is a relief, but I think it's looking good, and we'll just hold tight, make sure. We're just seeing solid rocket booster separation now.
There we go.
And we're on the main engines, and we're into stage two. We should see those main engines cut off at about 8 minutes and 38 seconds.
What are they doing right now?
Well, of course, they're reading the same checklist I've got here. They're looking at their displays, their engine parameters, monitoring their instruments.
Three APUs still running.
Of course, we spend 90% of our ascent training for aborts, so I'm sure that if anything were to go wrong, they'd automatically, you know, go to that procedure, but it looks very good at this point.
We'll be hearing some call-ups here shortly from the Capcom about the capability to reach transatlantic sites. Velocity 6,200 feet per second, altitude 41 nautical miles, downrange distance 60 nautical miles.
I can envision five sets of smiles up there on board the orbiter, Bonnie.
Well, I think they'll actually smile a little bit later. They may be smiling now, but they're listening to their calls and watching their engines. We have a number of calls about what our abort sites are available should we lose an engine,
mm-hmm,
up until the 8-minute point. And
here's a woman who is so utterly happy.
Discovery, two engine, Marone.
Roger.
That call-up indicating Kent's Discovery may be able to achieve a transatlantic abort at Marone if that were to become necessary. Return status, mission control, positions hold, report go. Three engines still 104%, velocity 7,600 feet per second, altitude 53 nautical miles, downrange distance 107 nautical miles.
Bar time tonight.
It all started here, launch pad 39B.
Discovery, negative return.
And that call means that...
negative return.
That call-up indicates Discovery now can no longer turn around and return to the launch site in the event of an abort. 4 minutes, 20 seconds, velocity 8,700 feet per second, altitude 59 nautical miles, downrange distance 148 nautical miles. Standing by for press to ATO call.
Press to ATO. Select Banjo.
Select out.
Call-up indicates Discovery could reach an abort to orbit on two engines if that were to become necessary. 5 minutes, 3 seconds. Velocity 10,300 feet per second. Altitude 65.7 nautical miles. Downrange distance 203 nautical miles.
It's good to hear now that you could, if you had to abort, you could do it with the two engines now.
That's right. In fact, what he was calling was one of the abort calls that we have. There'll be several called up here as we get farther down range. We have, the last one is an abort to orbit. Should we have an engine failure, we can still make it to a lower orbit, as was described earlier, at 105 miles.
Mm-hmm.
Discovery, Crest Amigo, Group Banjul 109.
Okay.
Roger.
And you've got that checked out.
Yes.
Cutoff call indicating they can proceed to normal main engine cutoff on two engines if that were to become necessary.
Discovery, performance nominal.
Roger, nominal.
And as each second ticks off, the United States space program is looking better and better and coming back.
Well, it appears that we are going to make it to orbit.
Discovery, single engine Banjul 104.
Everything is...
That call-up indicates Discovery could achieve a single engine landing at Banjul if that were to become necessary. Banjul, one of the transatlantic abort sites.
Main engine start, 7, 6. Start, 3.
This is a replay of what happened a short while ago here at
liftoff. Liftoff. Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll program. Houston now controlling. 3 inches at 104%. 3 good APUs, 3 good fuel cells.
Tony Clark is in Houston at the Johnson Space Center, and as we indicated 7 seconds after Discovery was off the launch pad 39B, Johnson assumed control over there. Tony, what was it like in that room where you were? We felt the earth shake here in Florida.
Bernie, it was exciting. People here are all excited. In Mission Control, about a block away, cheers went up. Everybody's excited. Everybody is waiting, though, for a very important call, a call that's coming up, and that's MECO. That's Main Engine Cutoff. Dick Covey said prior to this launch, said, stick with us till MECO, because that's the important call when we get to orbit and the main engine's cut off. But here we've had cheers periodically. Cheers as the shuttle launched off the pad. Cheers went up again when we had the separation of the solid rocket boosters. People have been standing around the monitors here in the simulation room in building 9A throughout the morning, watching, hoping that things would, that the weather conditions would improve, wanting to see a launch today. They got what they wanted. They saw the launch. We saw thumbs go up. As I said, we had cheers go up in the Space Center and Mission Control here in the building 9A. People are just very excited. It has been a long 2.5 years for the people here at the Johnson Space Center. Everybody is much like a family here at the at NASA, and everybody has been waiting and hoping for this. Now everybody is standing by waiting for that call that comes 8 minutes after launch, the MECO call, the main engine cutoff, when they get up to orbit. And as Bonnie knows quite well, that's perhaps our next really big call. Bernie?
Bonnie, what does it look like? Okay. Was that it?
Yeah, we're nominal MECO.
Okay, and so that means, as you smile and I smile and everybody's happy, that means at this point?
Means at this point we can get on with the business of what we're supposed to do in orbit. We're going to deploy a satellite today, and then we're going to perform some experiments in material science and in medicine, biology, physiology, and come back in 4 days.
Yes, and they're going to put out that satellite in a little less than 6 hours. Your network of record will continue its live coverage of this truly historic launch of Discovery in a moment.
Main engine start, 7,
great.
6, start, 3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff! Liftoff, Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll program, Houston now controlling.
As the Discovery astronauts head for orbit, we're going to head across away from the Kennedy Space Center here. Jeff Levine, you were with these thousands of people who are out there watching. What's it like out there now?
Well, Bernie, it's pure happiness. I think that's the proper way of characterizing it. You can see perfectly the liftoff, the orange plume breaking the sky, and then a few seconds later you could hear the roar, and then you could hear the cheers, and you could see the tears. And one person who came all the way from the Washington, D.C. area is Mary Beard. Your first launch in person, what was it like? Tell me.
Absolutely fantastic. Unreal. It's hard to believe.
What brought you down here? It's a long way.
I've always wanted to see the shuttle go up. Last mission, we were working with the computer, so I couldn't get down. I promised myself I'd get down. Before I retired, September 7th. And
so you're working with the space program?
No, not no more. I just retired.
But you did.
Yeah.
Did you have a lot of trepidation about it? After all, we all know what happened last time.
I thank God it went up safe. Thank God. Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
Mary Beard, thanks for coming.
Love
and
it.
We're going to throw to Bernie, and back to you, Bernie.
The Commander-in-Chief, the President of the United States, has been watching what's happened here.
Now, unless someone else has broken the news already, before we begin, I'd like to tell you that at 11:37, The Space Shuttle Discovery lifted off at the Kennedy Space Center. And it's now headed into orbit, and America is back in space. We're now looking forward to the successful completion of the Discovery mission and the safe return of her five-member crew. We salute the bravery of Rick Hauck, Dick Covey, Pinky Nelson, Mike Lounge, and Dave Hilmers, and we ask God to bless this important voyage. They sure were considerate in their timing. Just gave me time to get out here without being late. Well, after looking down the list of what all your organizations have done, I have to say you are America's good Samaritans. And I'm delighted to welcome you to the White House. This is a very special day for me. It's the last time I'll get to present the presidential citations for private sector initiatives. This is a program that we started here in 1984 to help recognize the outstanding volunteer efforts of business organizations and dedicated people like you. Today, there are some 4,500 sea flags waving.
As President Reagan speaks there at the White House, and we heard him announce to his audience, if they hadn't heard, that the Discovery is heading for orbit, I just can't help remembering that January day, I was at the White House along with the other anchors. We were getting a briefing because the President's State of the Union address was to be delivered that night, and we were sitting in the Roosevelt Room, just sitting down to lunch. And Donald Reagan, the then Chief of Staff, was seated at the end of the table. An aide walked in, handed him a note. His face just froze, and of course he was announcing that the Shuttle Challenger had blown up. And you recall what the President went through that day, the State of the Union address, what you, all of us, the nation, the families, the relatives, the friends, people around the world went through. What a difference nearly 3 years have made. The United States space program is heading on the wings of the shuttle, the orbiter right now, going into orbit, and we'll continue our live coverage, not only from the Kennedy Space Center, but from the Johnson Space Center as well. We'll be right back in just a moment.
Liftoff. Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roll program. Roger, roll, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll program. Houston now controlling. Three engines at 104%.
And welcome back, Bonnie. They're talking to Capcom now, you said just a second ago as we were coming out of that commercial.
Yes, the Capcom for Asset here is John Creighton. They were having a discussion with him about some sensors. I didn't follow it completely, but everything seems to be doing well. And at about 39 minutes, we'll perform what's called an orbiter maneuvering system burn. An Ohm's burn puts us into a circular orbit. And so that slight burn will put us at 160 miles, and then we'll continue with the rest of our on-orbit operations.
And what are they doing right now? You actually having flown the shuttle before, Bonnie has before us. I don't know whether you can see it, but she has laid out the second-by-second flight plan right now. And you're noting on my line here that Ohm's tube burn, very important in the sequence.
Well, yes, because it does put us into the proper orbit from which that we are able to stay in orbit instead of being in elliptical orbit, and also the orbit that we plan to deploy the satellite from, the TDRS. So we need this burn. What I have in front of me are copies of the checklist that the crew actually have on board, one being an ascent checklist, and the other is called a crew activity plan, which lays out our activities not only hour by hour, but once we get on orbit, you'll see it lays us out by minute. And this is what we spend up to a year or a year and a half rehearsing before we fly.
Before you ever go to the launch pad.
Absolutely.
And when we were coming out around, what was it, about 5:35 this morning, it was still dark outside, we were making our way in a car to our scenic work spot here. You were pointing out that right now, astronauts are training for missions that will occur in 1990, 91, 92.
Well, we have astronauts in our office following these missions. We work with the customers. We work with experimenters and even helping to design their hardware. We assign an official crew somewhere between a year and a half, depending on whether or not it's a space lab mission. So you can train 16, 18 months before you actually fly on a specific mission.
And the five men on this mission, they all are a very experienced crew.
They've each flown twice. They are members of both the 78 and 80 classes. So I have a couple classmates on that flight.
Mm-hmm. Which ones?
Well, Dave Hilmers and Mike Lounge were in my class.
Is it unusual for NASA to pack that many heavies, that many experienced pros, and two, three-fifths of these guys represent some of the best combat flying in Vietnam, and thousands of miles flight time behind that stick? Is it unusual?
Well, it's actually a combination of factors. Most of his crew had been put together ever before the accident.
Mm-hmm.
They were to fly a different mission. They had a different pilot. He went back to the Air Force. But we have three military astronauts on board and two civilians. It's a typical mix. I think that there was an effort to try to make sure we had at least a flown person on because of the importance of this mission. But generally what we try to do and have done in the past is to mix the crews, because obviously you have to start someone flying at some point to give them experience, to be experienced. And on my flight, it was my first flight, but with four other people.
We will continue our coverage of the flight of the Shuttle Discovery in a moment.
This is a CNN special report, America's Space Mission. At the Kennedy Space Center, CNN's Bernard Shaw.
Officially, NASA calls the Shuttle Discovery Space Shuttle Mission STS-26. Well, a short while ago, after STS-26 lifted off from Launch Pad 39B, in launch control, the administrator, the head of NASA, Dr. James Fletcher, addressed his people.
Well, to start with, wow! That was really something. It's been a long wait, 2.5 years or a little bit better than that. You guys have been working your tails off for the last, I don't know how long, long hours, overtime. Fixed all the problems, ready to go. When it's time to go, we went. All I can say is that the nation owes you a lot, and will continue to owe you a lot in the months and years to come. This is the first of a new era, as we've said before. Congratulations for a job well done.
And Dr. Fletcher, no doubt pleased that he was proved wrong. You might recall, if you were with us early this morning, CNN's John Holloman talked with Jim Fletcher, and he allowed us how he thought that it was a 50-50 chance it could go either way, that it wouldn't go, and he said, it might not go. And of course it went, and he's bursting with pride. John Zarella is down in the VIP section, and he has a very important guest. John?
That's right, Bernie. With me is Kathleen Beers, and like so many of us, Kathleen was here 2.5 years ago on that very unfortunate day. But Kathleen was here for a very special reason. She was one of the 10 finalists in the Teacher in Space contest, and it must have been an agonizing 2 years and 8 months for you.
It was a long 2.5 years, it really was, and it was almost approaching the 3 years, and it's been a long wait. I feel so exhilarated now. I feel really weightless. I feel like I put in a month's work in when those main engines were lit. I mean, this one's for Challenger. I was just so excited. This is, I feel like I'm floating. This is fantastic.
I imagine it must feel as if a giant weight has been lifted off your shoulders.
You bet. My feet aren't touching the floor. and the ground. And I remember several times when Scobie would say in training, when things were like lagging a little bit, and Scobie would say, time to press on, time to press on. And believe me, when they lit those main engines, all I could think of Scobie saying, time to press on. And I thought, go for it. This is for that whole crew. Their mission continues. This put closure to it, because up to that time, the chapter was unwritten. And today, we're on our way. It's all been too good. From 1904, Wright Brothers, we grew wings at Kitty Hawk, and we put footprints on the moon, and Skylab and Space Lab and the shuttle missions. And we can't, there's no going back. We've got to go out there for the 21st century and explore and discover. And I'm just so glad we're back on track.
Well, your eyes were glued to the launch pad. I know some of us didn't want to
glued.
Watch.
I was, they were glued. I was crying. Oh, it was just fantastic.
What's next now for you?
I hope to be on it. I really do. In fact, someone said at the hotel this morning, what will you be thinking 5 seconds before liftoff? And I said, Godspeed, and I wish I were on it.
And you have no reservations of flying on the space shuttle?
None at all. Absolutely none. They're, pioneering is a special privilege, and there are things in life that are worth the discovery, the exploration, that transcend the risk and the danger.
You're a school teacher. 10th, 11th, 12th graders. What do you say to those many school children who watched 2 years and 8 months ago and now watched again?
Things are fine. It's fixed. Problems arise, and the space system will always be state-of-the-art and the edge of tech, on the edge of technology, and nothing is completely safe, and they need to realize that now. We haven't built the safe car yet. I had a month after the tragedy, I had a hairdryer that was recalled. So when you think of those things, we need the sense of to proceed on. There is a sense of element, a sense of danger, and if it weren't for really the vision of Columbus and those people on Westward Ho, we wouldn't be standing right here. If they would have calculated and thought out, well, it won't work, because, in fact, one of the things that really gave me strength when Dick Rutan and Gina Yeager came back from Voyager, they had shared a tribute with me that I read to all the audiences, and to have a dream and follow that dream and go for it. And because so many times I've done a lot of mountain climbing and still transatlantic, and people will say it's dangerous or why do you do it, and you just have to follow that dream and go for it. And it's for the I want to make sure I when I'm gone I want to feel like I left the place, I've left Earth a better place, that I just didn't journey through, that there was an imprint and I made a difference.
And obviously the dream now continues. Back to you, Bernie.
Thank you very much, John. And Bonnie Dunbar, what a difference 29 minutes can make. While we were listening to John's interview, Bonnie said it's good they got off because the bad stuff is closing in. You can see how gray it's gotten behind us. What a difference, 29 minutes, and it's almost dark here at the Cape.
Yes, we do have some weather moving in that probably would have affected the launch. Mm-hmm. I think it was a good time and everything worked well.
This is this formation that Valerie Voss had pointed out to us about 2 hours ago. It was off the coast, and she indicated, the radar indicated that it was moving closer, and my goodness, it's right on top of us. Well, they continue on their mission, the Discovery astronauts, the Discovery 5. Jeff Levine is off the reservation. You know, the Kennedy Space Center is a natural wildlife preserve. I even saw an eagle's nest, and there are many other forms of wildlife. But once you get off the Kennedy Space Center and go over to a small community called Titusville, you find that the roads to Titusville at this moment are still clogged, and people in Titusville proper are still talking about the fact that Discovery is up. Jeff?
Bernie, there was indeed some wildlife over here. The crowds were thrilled to see the launch go so perfectly. Among them, Mr. Dennis Bound from Sheffield, England. Dennis, the overseas perspective, your reaction?
Well, I should think it would be great. You know, I'm really marvelous.
What did you think when you saw it go up?
Well, I was really excited, you know. It seemed incredible that there could be men in that thing, you know.
Why did you come to watch? What was the special
reason? It's an experience, isn't it? It's an experience. And after the tragedy 3 years ago, you know, anything could have happened today, you know.
You camped overnight. You brought some goodies.
No, we've been here 2 days. We waited 2 days for the event. We thought it to be, you know, not much room, so we thought we'd come early, you know.
Was it worth it?
I think so, yeah. I think it was great.
Was this the first one you'd seen?
Yeah, yes. My friend's seen three. He saw the tragedy and the one before and this one, but this is the first I've ever seen. And it was worth coming for.
Is there anything like it overseas, or is this unique to America?
No, I don't think so. The Russians have got something similar, I believe, but England's not bothered just yet.
But today seems to be our day. Dennis Bowne,
it's your day,
thank you for joining us.
Yeah.
Bernie, back to you.
Well, just as this is the first time for Dennis, so it is the first time for this reporter, and I'll never forget, literally, the earth shaking. CNN will continue its live coverage of Discovery. They are successfully off. They're heading for orbit. In about 6 hours, they deploy that satellite, the Tedros. We'll continue our coverage as we look at the liftoff here some 29, 30 minutes ago. We'll be right back with more of the flight of Discovery.
Liftoff. Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll program. Houston now controlling.
We're go for main engine start. 7, 6, have main engine start. 3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff! Liftoff. Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger, roll, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll.
Well, you know, Jackie Gleason loved Florida. He spent so many years down here, especially in the wintertime, and I can't help feeling, were he alive, he would have to say, because of what's happened with Discovery, how sweet it is. We want to maintain the overview of this mission, so let's go to Tony Clark in Houston at Mission Control. Tony?
Bernie, I was just thinking what you said, and also the interview John Zarella had with one of the former teacher in space finalists. She was saying at the time that Dick Scobie, the commander of the Shuttle Challenger, used to say, press on, press on. And June Scobie, we talked to her a while back, and I asked her what she'd be thinking when the Discovery was launching, and she said she'd be thinking what Dick Scobie would be thinking if he were there. He would always say, go, baby, go. And I think that was the feeling we had here. I mean, there were people all around the Johnson Space Center who, as it was lifting off, were saying, go, baby, go. And the cheers that went up here and in Mission Control, it was an exciting thing. And just watching the opening, it's exciting to watch the launch again and again. Now we come down to the meaning of this, the four-day mission that the shuttle crew is on. The crew has planned 4 days, a conservative mission, a mission aimed at not only launching the Tedros satellite and doing a half dozen or a dozen rather experiments, but it is also a mission aimed at checking the shuttle out as well.
There have been scores of changes to the shuttle and the solid rocket boosters since the Challenger explosion 2.5 years ago. And though there have been repeated checks of the new designs, it is the launch itself which will be the ultimate shakedown test. The first few minutes are crucial.
We're not doing much, but we are concentrating and I'm watching what's happening. Because if something does happen that shouldn't happen, we have to be ready to cope with it.
I don't think there's anybody in our office that has ever flown on the space shuttle that didn't realize that the first 2 minutes of flight are the most hazardous of the entire mission because of the requirement that the solid rocket boosters work the way they're designed. We get to 2 minutes into flight and the solid rocket motors come off, then the first flight test objective is complete.
Once in orbit, the five crew members, all veterans of previous space flights, will begin preparations to deploy the 5,000-pound tracking and data relay satellite called Tedros. The satellite will be released from the shuttle's payload bay just 6 hours into the mission. Later, a two-stage solid rocket will boost the satellite to an orbit 22,000 miles high. From there, it can relay millions of bits of information from shuttles and satellites to ground tracking stations. One Tedros satellite is already in orbit. A second was destroyed with a Challenger. Eventually, NASA plans to have three Tedros satellites orbiting the Earth, allowing them to have communication with the shuttle throughout most of its orbit. Right now, Mission Control periodically loses contact with the shuttle when it goes out of range of ground tracking stations or the one Tedros satellite. Once the satellite is deployed, the crew will turn its attention to nearly a dozen scientific experiments, including one designed to help AIDS research. It involves growing tiny crystals, which, because of the microgravity of space,
grow in a way that makes it easier for researchers to determine the shape of the crystal's molecules.
Then once they know the shape of these molecules, they can design another molecule, a drug, that fits in, locks in, and either enhances the action of this or disables it in the case of this AIDS enzyme that we're carrying, that disables the enzyme that keeps the virus from reproducing.
There were also experiments proposed by students, including one to test the strength of certain metals in weightless conditions. Once the experiments are underway, there's time for one of the fun parts of the mission, looking out the window.
One of the best places is in the front window, not for taking pictures, but just for being a tourist, because we fly around upside down most of the time, nose forward. So you just get in the front windows there and kind of lay on the ledge like a lookout and just watch the horizon come toward you.
Mike Lounge, Dick Covey, Rick Hauck, Dave Hilmers, and Pinky Nelson have been preparing for this flight for 2 years. They are eager to get the mission underway.
You've invested so much, and so many pieces have had to come together to get you there where you are, say, on your back a couple minutes before launch. Mostly you're praying and hoping that nothing goes wrong to screw it up.
One of the things, that some of the first shuttle tests have occurred already, those first parts of the shakedown test, the SRBs appeared to work well on the launch. And one of the things that's going to happen now, we saw the SRBs, the solid rocket boosters, fall off as the shuttle climbed towards orbit. Now NASA will recover those solid rocket boosters and they will take a look at them. They will take them apart and they will examine them just to make sure that they work the way that they were supposed to work. And the goal there is to make sure not only that this was a safe flight, but that future shuttle flights are just as safe. Another thing that appeared to have worked well is the line of communications. As John Holloman reported earlier this morning, he said one of the things the Rogers Commission in investigating the Challenger disaster came up with was the need for better communication all up and down the lines of NASA, so that if someone, an engineer, anyone, had a concern about the possibilities that something might happen to the shuttle, that that information would get to the proper people. We heard right before launch a various checklist, everyone saying it's okay to launch, going up and down, opening the lines of communication. So another portion of this shuttle mission appears to be headed in the right direction, and we'll be following the shuttle mission throughout its 4 days. I'm Tony Clark, CNN, reporting live from the Johnson Space Center.
Tony, the world, of course, is watching the Discovery 5 up there aboard the shuttle, the orbiter. But what about the other five? What about the other people so important to NASA, to Discovery, and to the five men on board? What about the wives? Yesterday, in a very rare interview, correspondent Jeff Levine sat down and talked with two of the wives. Let's listen in.
I think the logical place to begin is what I'm thinking of. This is not a low-pressure enterprise. Obviously, the emotions are cooking. How do you cope?
Minute to minute. Just kind of handle each morning and then the afternoon, and don't look too far ahead, and just kind of move along. If you look too far ahead or spend too much time thinking about it, you tend to get rather anxious, and it's a little bit easier just to keep lots of friends and family and activity around you, and time passes pretty quickly that way.
Is this, in a sense, like being a policeman's wife or a fireman's wife? This is a factor in the equation of your marriage. You have to live with it.
I've often compared it to that. We're no different than a lot of other spouses whose husbands have a high-risk job. They accept it, and you live with it, and that's the way.
It's
you,
them. It's just part of them,
and you accept that.
I suppose, though, that what happened to Challenger has to color your thinking about this mission to some degree. You're only human. You can't expunge it from your consciousness totally. Does it drift in and out, this nightmare?
Yeah, I don't think there's any doubt. It would be foolish of us not to look at that every now and then and examine the feelings that you have about it. That was a terrible loss to the nation, but to each of us personally, because they were close friends. I mean, aside from the fact that they were astronauts and whatever they were doing, it was like losing a close friend, but losing several at the same time. And that was very, very devastating for all of us. It's like anything else. When you are faced with the stark reality of it and you have to face it, then you do. It's easy to kind of, I think for Covey's last flight, I really didn't allow myself any time to think about those sort of possibilities. That just wasn't something that could happen.
Is that the way you deal with it?
I did last time. I really didn't worry about that. I was not so very different from most of the nation. And that was just not something. It's like I don't worry about getting in my car in the morning and that I'm going to have an accident. I just don't worry about that. I assume that can't happen to me. And I assumed the same thing with Covey shuttle flight and with every shuttle flight that came along. That the Challenger accident stopped that, the privilege of being able to be quite so naive about it. And yeah, you do have to grow up a little bit and say, okay, now let's face the facts. These things can happen, and if they do, there's not a lot of control that I have over it, and there's not a lot of reason for me to worry and fret and stew, because it's not going to change the course of events. They're going to unfold the way they'll unfold.
After the Challenger, Mike and I talked quite a lot, but one of the things that he said that really surprised me was, you know, of the two jobs, you have the tougher job. And it surprised me because I had never heard it verbalized. But the fun part, the execution of it, I mean, he's busy. He doesn't have to worry about all the various and sundry things at home and the bearing up of all the people, all of the family. We are the people who are left here with the family, with the children, and we're the people who have to carry on. And very much so, that's true.
In terms of explaining things to children, is there a simple or relatively easy way of doing that, or do answers
lead to more questions?
There's never a simple way to explain to a child.
I think every child handles it differently. I think after the Challenger accident, watching the way my children handled it versus the way other children handled it, it was an interesting, I mean, I thought that we would be able to sit down and discuss this in kind of the same fashion, and with my children, it was not their fear or their amazement at all. It had very little to do with the fact that these were astronauts that had been killed. They were amazed that a dad could die. That wasn't the normal event of things. They didn't really do much connection between the fact that those parents were doing for a living the same thing that Covey did for a living. That was not part of the equation at all. It was more of dealing with the fact that we all are mortal, and at some point it may end, and we don't have any control over that date or time.
To what extent is it possible to keep NASA out of family affairs? Can you have a family life amidst the hoopla and the work?
The workload's got to be fantastic.
We are absolutely normal people. We have absolutely normal family lives. And until I...
Speak for yourself.
when I left Houston the first of this week...
Was he an engineer, too?
Well, fairly much so. I mean, we're just like any other two-person working couple, and Kathy and Covey are the same way. We juggle household and children and make things work, but we're fairly normal.
I'm still waiting for normal to come back. It was somewhere when I was 20, and I'm expecting it again at 60. I don't know.
We have
I
our
gave
moments.
It up in between.
We all have our moments when it becomes. I mean, you do a juggling act. Mm. Any professional couple or any couple where both of you work do a juggling act. And Mike and I have always compared it to juggling until you drop a ball, and then everything stops. You pick it all up and you put it all back together again, but you make it work through effort and through teamwork.
So it's a special life, is it not, Kitty?
It is, and it part of it is knowing that that you're helping make history, and you're helping mold the direction that the space program will go. That's part of their job.
Is that the special aspect of Discovery? This is an historic mission. No one can quarrel with that. This is your place.
Oh yes, this is the place to be right now in space history. We are going to make it work.
No, I think that they. I know when Covey came home or called me to tell me that he'd been selected for this flight, it was, you know, he was probably standing on his desk, jumping up and down. He was absolutely ecstatic about the opportunity that was being afforded him. And I remember asking him at the time, "Are you a little nervous about this?" Well, that was not even part of the equation at all. I mean, this was, you know, I'm having an opportunity to start things back on right track, get things going again, and I wouldn't miss it for the world.
And we're certainly glad that Kathy Covey and Kitty, Mike Lounge's wife, took time out yesterday on the eve of this historic launch to sit down and talk with CNN interesting listening to them. Indeed, strength up there in the heavens and strength down here represented in these women as they carry on. Incidentally, in the early 1970s, Mike Lounge flew combat missions over Southeast Asia. He was flying a big F-14 Phantom jet off the flight deck of the Carey Enterprise. But Lounge is now aboard a much different flying machine on a more peaceful mission. John Mike Lounge, former Navy pilot, assigned as mission specialist on Discovery. 42 years old, married, two children, astronaut since 1981, with 170 hours in space. Mike Lounge, a graduate of the Naval Academy, is a Vietnam War veteran with 99 combat missions as a Navy pilot. He has degrees in physics, mathematics, and astrogeophysics. The upcoming mission will not be Mike Lounge's first aboard Discovery. He flew on the orbiter's most recent voyage in August and September of 1985. Earlier this year, Lounge was asked by CNN's John Zarella about safety precautions for the upcoming flight.
It'll be as safe as we can make it, reasonably. What's the saying about ships? They're safe in the harbor, but that's not what they're for. So, yeah, it's as safe as we can reasonably make it, and the agency management from Admiral Truly on down has said we won't fly until we're sure we're ready to fly. And we've taken all reasonable precautions fixing the known problems. We'll do that and get on with it. If you ride it once, you know it's not routine.
Asked what it's like to sit in a spacecraft and wait for blastoff, Lounge said, "You really get launchitis once you get strapped in. You really want to do it." Mike Lounge, mission specialist on the Discovery flight, is from Burlington, Colorado. Well, they really wanted to do it. They are doing it at this hour, at this second. When that beautiful orbiter lifted off, my colleague here, Bonnie Dunbar, was jumping up and down in the chair and watching, and I had a pair of binoculars, and I almost fell off the back of this riser body following it up until a cloud came overhead, and we had to stop and go to the cameras. But there was another reaction. NASA workers and also news media representatives, people from around the world, some 4,000 of them, they had their own reaction. Let's see what it was like.
Discovery's three-man engines on full power. A beautiful liftoff.
Discovery streaking into space aboard a column of flame.
Discovery will be back in space again.
Everybody in America felt this was important. The country cares, I think, a lot.
And to see this thing to go flawlessly, man, it is just super.
Oh, this was the best one.
And I remember several times when Scobie would say in training, when things were like lagging a little bit, and Scobie would say, "Time to press on, time to press on." And we'll...
They're pressing on in space. Bonnie, your thoughts?
Well, I think that it's a rare privilege to have the opportunity to fly it, but the fact that we launched today is a tribute to all of those men and women, engineers, scientists, technicians, secretarial support that helped make it fly. And I think they can all take a great deal of pride in what happened today.
And I personally thank you on behalf of everybody for helping us bring this worldwide audience the coverage of this historic launch. For Bonnie Dunbar, I'm Bernard Shaw, and for everybody here at CNN, in Florida, in Houston, in Atlanta, we thank you. Goodbye from the Kennedy Space Center. In Florida, Discovery is still going.
10, we're go for main engine start. 7, 6, main engine start. 3, 2, 1, 0, and liftoff! Liftoff, Americans return to space as Discovery clears the tower.
Roger all, Discovery.
Crew confirms roll program, Houston now controlling. Three engines at 104%. Three good APUs, three good fuel cells. Standing by to begin, throttle down to 65%. Engines throttling down now to maintain a certain speed as the spacecraft passes through max Q. Three engines at 65% now.
The nation, possibly the world, held its breath this morning as the Space Shuttle Discovery left the launch pad. Most couldn't help but remember what happened in 1986 when the Space Shuttle Challenger exploded just minutes after takeoff. But following the delays, this morning's launch went as planned, and the focus has now switched to the next part of the mission. Joining us from the launch site, John Conway, Director of Payload Management and Operations at the Kennedy Space Center. And he says the Discovery's mission is twofold, to get the U.S. back into space and to launch a TDRS satellite. Welcome, Mr. Conway, and thank you so much for being with us. And step one has been accomplished, and look at that beaming look on your face. Everyone feeling the same way. How did it go, in your opinion?
Well, it was just, I tell you, it was just thrilling and exciting. We were all nervous. We'd been there before when times were not so good. And to be there and be a part of it and be a part of getting America back into space and getting the space agency back on track, it's just a thrill of a lifetime. We didn't relax up there when that thing lifted off this time, I can tell you that. We didn't relax when the solids were burned out. We didn't relax until that thing got in orbit. And the team was just overcome with emotion at where we were. Just a thrilling thing. We handed out American flags, and we all were waving the flags in the firing room and just thrilled and excited about being an American on a day like this.
Yes, of course, and while we couldn't be right there with you, we certainly saw Bernard Shore's excitement, and we share it all. Let's move to step two and talk a little bit about the TDRS. What is it? What do you expect to accomplish with this particular satellite?
Okay, Sonia, this satellite is very critical to us in terms of establishing communications for our satellites and our shuttle as they go around the Earth. What we're doing with this satellite is forming a three-satellite network. We have one TDRS that we put up in 1983. This will be the second TDRS that we will put in orbit. With two TDRSs, we can attain an 85% coverage of the Earth's surface, so that any time that we have a satellite in orbit, or the shuttle in orbit, which is a satellite at the time it's in orbit, then what we're doing, we're having continuous communications with those through 85% of the entire trajectory. And you don't have that today because of the Earth ground stations, where we have dropout and we lose critical data. That becomes very critical for a manned operation, such as the space shuttle. It's also very critical for something like a space telescope that we'll be putting up in another year and a half, so that we have that data as scientists are working with it. They can move it and name it and do all those things that they're going to do.
We know that there is really a projected view of the commercial use of payloads, and I wonder if we can just project into the future a little bit. How do you see the commercial use of the payload, and how would it refer back to us, the citizens of this country, as we see what's happening with monies being spent for space programs?
Well, Sonia, the future of space and the commercial use of space is something that we're just now beginning to explore. We're all familiar with communication satellites that bring us TV. We're all familiar with the weather forecasting that we get from our satellite systems. And again, the TDRS we fly today is a communication satellite. Those are the uses that we have made use of, that every American sitting in front of his TV, almost all Americans, use a satellite in some part of that transmission system. And we see the weather report at night. We see the satellite picture. We're all a part of that. The areas we're exploring now, and we have some 11 middecks in addition to the TDRS on board this shuttle, are things that will tell us, can we do manufacturing operations in space? Can we develop medicines in space? Can we find new techniques and new tools? And that's the thing that's key. This is leading us to, hopefully, our space station, which will be both a science lab in space and a manufacturing capability in space. So space is just now beginning to be explored and used, but many byproducts have come out of it, byproducts in medicine and other things, as we develop the capability to go into space. And now we must learn, are there things in zero gravity that we can do commercially other than the things we know we can do, which are the satellite industry?
One quick last question. We know that the Department of Defense has a number of payloads scheduled. We wonder about the availability and if there might be that watchbird in the sky that everyone could use to make sure that there isn't any action going on anywhere in the world that we're not all aware of.
Well, that is a very critical part of it. and I didn't add that, but I should have said that, that space is a critical and integral part of our national defense system. And that, too, is why it's important. But, you know, today we made it. We did it. We've worked 2.5 years to get to the place we are. And it was 2.5 years in which we suffered a lot of criticism, not only from others, but from ourselves, in which we looked at everything we did down here and how we could do it better, how we could do it more efficiently. Today, that work paid off, and it paid off for our whole team. So it was a very emotional day for us. It's not over yet. We're looking forward to about 5:30 this afternoon, getting the go for the TDRS deploy from the shuttle. We're looking to make sure those IUS two-stage motors burn properly later in the evening, and we put this satellite in orbit where it belongs.
Well, we want to thank you so much for being with us. Good of you to take that break to share the information, and we'll be right there with you.
Thank you, Sonia. I'm going back over now to eat beans with the launch team.
Thanks for being here again.